For centuries, humans have considered colonizing or even terraforming Mars. Today we will look at exactly that, but instead discuss the issues and challenges with traveling to Mars and forming a colony there. We'll mainly focus on the issues with creating a colony there, as in my experience, folks tend to usually only discuss the journey to Mars. And I think it's also really useful to know why we would go there. Most folks know that companies such as NASA and SpaceX aim and have plans to send humans to Mars in the future, but most don't understand why we want to. So why do we want to go to Mars? Well, for one thing, Earth is someday going to run out of resources and space to live, and when we start to realise that, we will have to come up with new ideas to make room for new space. Concepts such as Dyson spheres, rotating habitats, ring worlds, and so on will get discussed much more often as they become more and more vital. And so, beginning a colony on Mars is a fantastic solution to wanting more space, and is one reason why we would want to colonize Mars. It's also an essential step to improve human survival, because if all life on Earth was wiped out by a large asteroid like the dinosaurs were, then a self-sustaining colony on Mars would serve as a great backup for humanity. And we've been quite fortunate enough to get a planet as good as Mars. It has about the same day as Earth, only an extra 40 minutes, and has ice on its surface that we could potentially use in the future. And anyways, it's one of the best and closest options in our solar system. Mercury and Venus are far too hot, and the moon, well, the moon is a pretty good candidate for a colony, but it isn't a good candidate for a reason that I'm about to discuss. Since the end of the last century and this century, we have sent many rovers to Mars and they've made quite a lot of discoveries. However, Bill Nye said in an episode of Star Talk Radio that humanity should focus more on sending humans to Mars and not robots, because humans could make discoveries 10,000 times as fast as robots do. Mars is the next logical place to explore and discover new things. That's another reason to go there. With some human work on the red planet, there's a greater chance of finding life there. And now you can see why the moon isn't a good candidate for this very reason. Although it's very unlikely that we'll find life elsewhere, it's a lot more likely to find life on Mars rather than the moon. Not only making discoveries, but also just simply to adventure. Another reason is to inspire future generations to go even further than the previous. Landing humans on the moon inspired future astronauts, engineers, and so on, who were in secondary or middle school at that time. So now that we are familiar with a few reasons on why we would want to go to Mars, we shall now discuss the issues with forming a civilization there. So here's a list of some of the biggest issues with colonizing Mars that I could think of. Number 1. The radiation humans would have to deal with. Number 2. The gravity there. Number 3. The atmosphere there. Number 4. Not having enough materials or money. Number 5. We are inexperienced. Number 6. Time lag, and number 7, some other issues. Firstly, the radiation there. We're very lucky here on Earth. The Earth naturally protects us from radiation due to its thick and dense atmosphere and magnetic field. The magnetic field deflects most of the solar wind, which would strip away the ozone layer that protects us from harmful radiation. However, some particles from the solar wind can enter, which in turn is what the aurora is. Most celestial bodies have magnetic fields, however most are not as good as Earth's. Mars is no exception, although its magnetic field is exceptionally weak compared to Earth's. This is a problem. When astronauts land there and set up a base, they will be constantly bombarded by a lot more radiation than humans have ever experienced. And not only landing on Mars, but actually making your way there, astronauts will be fully exposed to the radiation as they have no cover like we do here on Earth. Of course, on the route to Mars, astronauts on board the craft could also experience unpredictable radiation bursts, exposing the astronauts to a lot more radiation. Furthermore, to get to Mars it takes around somewhere from 100 days to 300 days, and so the astronauts on board are spending all that time getting bombarded by all this radiation from the sun and the constant background radiation of the universe, which can have effects such as DNA ionizing, cancers forming, and organs damaging. So it'll be a pretty good idea to stop the astronauts from undergoing this radiation. There's two ways we can do this. First, we could reduce the travel time, both by choosing the exact time to leave Earth and the quickest trajectory to get to Mars. The ideal time to send the spacecraft with all our astronauts inside is when Mars is the closest point to Earth, which is every 2 years, being at about 55 million kilometers from Earth. Of course, you wouldn't leave Earth as Mars is at its closest point. You'd much rather leaving days before it is, so that your spacecraft meets Mars at its closest point. Ideally, you'd want to travel in a straight line as possible, to reduce the distance the spacecraft is traveling, and so using less fuel. Travel time also depends on how fast the craft is traveling. How fast the craft is traveling depends on how much fuel we're willing to burn. The second way to stop the astronauts from receiving as much radiation is to design the spacecraft so that it blocks as much radiation as possible. This just comes down to how engineers design the craft, and with most of these issues, there are issues that are easily overcome. The most difficult issue that I can see is not having enough money, but we shall discuss that later on. The second issue is the gravity there. Martian gravity is about 38% of the gravity here on Earth, since Mars has less mass than Earth. So if you weigh 100 pounds on Earth, you would weigh only 38 pounds on Mars. The Moon has an even lower gravity of 16.6% of Earth's gravity. We've never had anyone stay on the Moon or Mars for that matter for a lengthy amount of time that would enable us to see the effects of the low gravity there. The longest anyone has been on the Moon was the final mission of NASA's Apollo program in 1972, where they were on the Moon for a little over 3 days, while the entire mission took over 12 days. With that being said, we do have fairly good guesses on what would happen based on the effects the astronauts on the International Space Station experience. Ever since the first astronauts went up to the space station, NASA discovered that, due to the low gravity, the body works a lot less, causing muscle deterioration and loss of bone density. To solve this, astronauts need to regularly exercise, and on average, they do this 2 hours a day. However, to tackle this, we could create artificial gravity. This way it would be just like on Earth and astronauts wouldn't need to do exercise, which gives them a lot more time. At the moment, we know of two ways to create gravity, either somehow grab a ton of mass and use its natural gravity, or using spin to create fake gravity. This could be accomplished by rotating a large structure in a shape such as a cylinder, ring, or torus. It's the same thing you feel in rides like roller coasters, where you are pushed to one side. Now, this solution is great for getting to Mars, but on the surface it would be a lot more difficult to have a rotating structure. So it's whether it's worth spending that extra money for the astronauts' benefit or not. This type of artificial gravity is seen in a lot of science fiction books, such as one of my favourite books, 2001 A Space Odyssey by Arthur C. Clarke, and also The Martian. The third issue is the atmosphere there. Mars's thin atmosphere makes landing on Mars very difficult, which is why Mars rovers have stranger landing methods. The air composition is completely useless, as it's made up of 95% carbon dioxide and small percentages of oxygen, argon, and other gases. The thin air on Mars also does a poor job of capturing heat. A good idea would be to terraform Mars, although it's very difficult and would take a long time. One of the key steps in doing so would be to make the atmosphere more like Earth's. We'd have to make it thicker and alter its composition. One way to do this would be to trigger a global warming effect, introducing more greenhouse gases such as carbon dioxide, methane, or ammonia. We could get methane from mining rocks on Mars, or if we're feeling ambitious, then we could hit Mars with some asteroids to release ammonia. This would be done by somehow capturing an asteroid from either the edge of the solar system, so the Oort cloud, or even the asteroid belt. The fourth issue is not having enough materials or money. It seems to me that this would be the most likely issue for humans. A manned mission to Mars would be exceptionally expensive. A few years back, NASA estimated that it would cost them at least $100 billion over the course of 30 to 40 years, and that number might even be too low. After all, the ISS was once thought to cost $10 billion over the course of 10 years, but turned out to cost 10 times that. $100 billion is a very large figure in comparison to previous Mars rovers such as Curiosity that only cost $2.5 billion. With that being said, I undoubtedly want NASA, or SpaceX for that matter, to send a manned mission to Mars. If they can't meet the money needed, NASA have instead suggested that they may do another mission to the Moon, possibly even to form a colony there. Seen as SpaceX are pretty confident with future manned missions to Mars, NASA forming a colony on the moon would give SpaceX a bit more beforehand knowledge before they colonize Mars. SpaceX plans to send its first cargo mission to Mars in 2022. What's even more exciting though is its second mission, including both cargo and a crew, which will be preparation for future crew flights, and the spacecraft will be the beginning of our first Mars base, which we can build from to create a thriving city and eventually a self-sustaining civilization on Mars. The fifth issue is that humans are inexperienced. The aforementioned colony on the moon would give SpaceX some helpful insight and advice for the more ambitious job of colonizing Mars. It's possible that SpaceX's first manned Mars mission encounters an unknown problem, resulting in all of the crew dying. Having said that, the best way to learn is from our mistakes. This issue always has some degree in every space exploration mission, but we always end up just learning from mistakes, making future missions better executed. The sixth issue is time lag. This is probably the least affecting and the least thought about issue on my list. This includes messages and signals taking a long time to get from Earth to Mars or vice versa. Radio signals can take anywhere from 4 minutes to 24 minutes to get to Mars, depending on where Mars is in its orbit. This means that there couldn't be phone calls between the two planets, so messages or voice recordings would have to be used. Friends and family connections are likely to get very distant, as it's too time-consuming and troublesome to have a conversation or text each other. That could drive someone mad, not having any loved ones to talk to or any real friends, just colleagues. That's why it's pretty important that a crew going to colonize a planet and be pretty much on their own for at least more than a year has to be good friends and close to make it at least bearable for them in that manner. And now some other issues that I'll briefly talk about. There is the contamination problem. As soon as we step foot on Mars, we have brought microbes, or life if you like, to Mars, despite how many checks the spacecraft and crew go through beforehand. This means that if we find a life on Mars, we might not be able to tell whether it originated on Mars or if we brought it over from Earth. There is also the problem of perchlorates in the soil. Perchlorates are salt compounds often used in rocket propellants, and they're exceptionally harmful for humans. They can cause aplastic anemia, when your bone marrow can't make any new red blood cells, and can also cause a granulocytosis, which makes your body create less or no white blood cells. So if we're going to grow our own food on Mars, then we'll either need to use our own soil or remove the perchlorates from the soil. Comment down below your thoughts on these issues. Make sure you subscribe for more content on astronomy and futurism. If you enjoyed this video, check out my most recent video or this playlist. Thank you so much for watching. Have a nice day.